right, welcome to Crossroads. Good morning. I'm Adam Steinbach, one of our pastors here. We're really excited that you're joining us today. We're in our series, Long Story Short, where we're examining some of the parables that Jesus taught. Now, these are short stories, but they contain powerful truths. And Jesus was a master storyteller, and he had this way of taking a simple story and then introducing some shocking element, a surprise, an unexpected twist that often caught his listeners off guard and just grabbed their attention. But, you know, a lot of times it was that shocking part of the story that contained or pointed to or revealed a deep spiritual truth. Now, we do have to be careful when we interpret the parables, because some interpreters get really creative in assigning all kinds of meanings to even the smallest details of the parables. And that can get us in trouble, because the point of Jesus' parables is usually pretty simple. There's usually not a bunch of complex secret meanings involved. And if we want to understand the parables, we really have to understand what was the message Jesus intended for his original audience. And that's important because today's parable is a story about the kingdom of heaven. Jesus was confronting these hypocritical religious leaders, the same ones who were about to have him arrested and condemned to the cross. And he confronts them with a parable to warn them about who will be in the kingdom of heaven and who won't be. And frankly, I can't think of a more important topic for us today. Now, this hits home for me because, as I mentioned last week, I've been having some health issues and been working with the doctors. They've been running various tests. And thankfully, these tests have kept eliminating some pretty serious issues, which is great. But as I went through these tests, the potential issue that wasn't getting ruled out was cancer. The nurse, initially, she gave me this brochure, and it had all these different explanations of what I might have, and so we kept crossing them out, but the one at the bottom was not getting crossed out. Now, admittedly, there was a pretty small chance that it was cancer, but as the other options kept getting ruled out, that was just kind of on our minds more and more. Well, a few weeks ago, we got to go on a family vacation, and it was a great time for us just to disconnect and be together as a family, be together with my wife. We had a really nice time. But in the back of my mind the whole time while we're gone was this nagging thought, you know, I might not be here for this next year. Because we just don't know, right? I mean, none of us is guaranteed tomorrow. So this morning, I'm listening to this parable with fresh eyes today, because understanding who will be in the kingdom and who won't be is a really big deal. Now, a few weeks ago, I did have a final test that thankfully for now seems to have really ruled out cancer, that's not the issue. So thanks, guys. Yeah, thanks. So we were really thankful. But none of us is guaranteed tomorrow, right? So this matters. It's really important for us to understand where we stand with God. Now, Jesus told this parable to challenge his hearers to evaluate where they stood with God. So that's what we're going to do today. In this story, he describes three different groups of people. Two of these groups will not be in heaven. And it's important for us to realize all of us here today are in one of these three groups. You are somewhere in this parable. And my prayer today is that you would leave with a really clear understanding of where you stand with God, because nothing else matters more. So let's study this parable today. We're going to dive in, and we're going to see three different groups of people and three essential truths of the kingdom. So let's read Matthew 22, verse 1. It says, Jesus spoke to them again in parables, saying, the kingdom of heaven is like a king who prepared a wedding banquet for his son. Now, weddings were a really big deal in Jesus' day. They were usually like a week-long celebration with all kinds of feasting and activities. They were the highlights of social life in a village.
But Jesus isn't talking about just any wedding. This is a royal wedding, the wedding feast of the king's own son. And Jesus chose a royal wedding to describe the kingdom of heaven because it's the most elaborate party possible. It was the biggest party imaginable. And to receive an invitation to the royal wedding, right, that was a great honor. I mean, you would be bragging to all your neighbors and friends. You'd be posting about it saying, hey, look who got invited to the big wedding. Right? The only thing better than getting invited to the royal wedding was actually being there. And that's why verse 3 is so shocking. Take a look. It says, the king, he sent his servants to those who had been invited to the banquet to tell them to come. But they refused to come. It was inconceivable that you would receive an invitation to the royal wedding and then refuse to come. You would never do that. It makes no sense. Look at verse 4. Keep reading. Then he sent some more servants and said, tell those who have been invited, I've prepared my dinner. My oxen and fattened cattle have been butchered and everything is ready. Come to the wedding banquet. But they paid no attention and went off, one to his field, another to his business. The rest seized his servants, mistreated them, and killed them. Okay, this would be a total shock to Jesus' hearers. Right? Refusing the king's wedding invitation, or worse, beating and killing his servants, that's nothing less than rebellion against the king. Okay, these people, they're staging an uprising. They are declaring their independence. That's why this first group is the enemies of God. Okay, the first group we see here are the enemies of God. And wow, that's a shocking twist to this story. It's exactly what the religious leaders in Jesus' day were doing. Right? They had the privilege, they had the honor of leading God's people. And yet when Jesus came from God to establish God's kingdom, by and large, the religious leaders rejected him. And they are the guests who've been invited to the wedding feast and refuse to come. I mean, it was shocking. It was unthinkable that they would reject their own Messiah, the one they were waiting for. But many of them did. And that helps us understand verse 7. Jesus continued, the king was enraged. He sent his army and destroyed those murderers and burned their city. Okay, maybe this sounds really harsh, until we realize this first group was rebelling against the king. Now, each of these groups help us understand an essential truth about the kingdom that's going to show us where we stand with God. In this first group, the enemies of God show us that rejecting God's invitation brings judgment. Rejecting God's invitation always brings judgment. This group represented the religious leaders in Jesus' day who rejected God's invitation. They rejected the Savior God sent, Jesus, and the destiny they chose was judgment and destruction. And many people today are making the same mistake. You know, they think they don't need God. They don't want God in their life. They want to be in charge of their own life. They want to do things their own way. They resent the idea that they're accountable to an almighty God. I recently got to reconnect with my best friend from high school. He lives in another country now, and so we don't get to see each other very much, but he was back in the States a few weeks ago, and we got to hang out. And every time Andy and I get together, even going back to high school, we always had really great debates and discussions. There's a lot of things we never see the same way, but it's a great friendship. And that didn't change a couple weeks ago. We were having a really good dialogue and discussion. But Andy is not a believer in Jesus. He's turned his back on Christianity. And as we were having a very healthy debate and disagreement about God, Andy got to the point where he just couldn't understand. And he turned to me, he says, Adam, I don't get it. I mean, you're an intelligent guy. You're highly analytical. I just don't see how you can believe this is true. You know, for Andy, it doesn't make sense. He couldn't understand why I would devote my life to following Jesus. He thinks it's foolish. I'm a fool for believing the Bible. But unfortunately, Andy won't stop long enough to examine the evidence and his own biases. He has rejected God's invitation, and that breaks my heart. I keep praying for him because I know rejecting God's invitation leads eventually to judgment, but I know God can still reach him. It's not too late yet. But notice in this group of the enemies of God, there's two types of people. Okay, there are those who are actively opposed to God, and there are those who are just kind of indifferent towards God. You know, they got better things to do. So maybe you're not in outward rebellion against God, but are you indifferent towards him? You know, you go about your life, you're concerned about your own interests. Maybe you pay God some lip service. Maybe you show up at church from time to time. But truth be told, you don't really need God in your life. And you're not interested in surrendering your life to him. Okay, friend, I got to warn you if that's you. Indifference is the same as outward rebellion. They are both rejecting God's invitation. There is no middle ground there. It's the same. And any type of rejection of God's invitation ultimately leads to judgment. Now, as Jesus continues his parable, he's going to talk about a second group and their response, which is going to lead us to the second essential truth about the kingdom. Look at verse 8. Then he said to his servants, "The wedding banquet is ready, but those I invited did not deserve to come. So go to the street corners and invite to the banquet anyone you find." So the servants went out into the streets and gathered all the people they could find, the good as well as the bad. And the wedding hall was filled with guests. So in another shocking twist, the elite, privileged guests are replaced by a bunch of ordinary folks off the street. Now, picture this. Picture it's Oscar night. But instead of filling up the theater with movie stars and the rich and powerful and famous, they fill up the theater with regular people off the street. Imagine some homeless guy walking down the red carpet in front of all of the cameras, along with a street vendor and a taxi driver, right? The elite, privileged guests are replaced by a new, unworthy group. And some of them are good people, some of them are bad people, but either way, they are unworthy to be at the king's wedding feast. This is the second group, those unworthy of God. They're not worthy of God. They're not worthy of the wedding feast. Again, it doesn't make sense. Why would the king invite these people to the feast? They don't deserve it. They're not good enough. But we see that the kingdom of heaven is going to be full of people we didn't expect to be there. People you never thought you would see in heaven. Now, there's an old story, might be true, it might not be, I don't know. But there's an old story that serial killer Jeffrey Dahmer may have come to Christ in prison before he was murdered. Now, if you don't understand how that's possible, then you don't understand the second essential truth of the kingdom that Jesus is showing us here. That the kingdom comes only with unlimited grace. The kingdom comes with unlimited grace. Listen, everybody who ends up in the kingdom of heaven does not deserve to be there. Some of them are pretty good people, but they're still sinners. Some of them are bad people. Either way, none of them are worthy to get into the king's banquet. Only the unworthy will be in heaven. And some of you really need to hear this morning. It does not matter what you've done. It does not matter how badly you've messed up. It does not matter how much you think you've disappointed God. Because it's not about you. Right? You will never measure up to God's standard. You're never going to be good enough. That's why it's about unlimited grace. That's why God sent Jesus. To take the punishment that you and I deserve because we could never get in on our own. We need a Savior. You need someone to pay the penalty for your sin. Now, some of you have heard that so many times, you don't actually hear it anymore. I've honestly talked with people in this church who feel like God's offer of forgiveness for everything we've done, that's great. It's beautiful. It's a wonderful thing. But it's for those other people. Some of you actually feel like, I'm just too unworthy. I've messed up too badly. I'm just too unclean. I'm just not the chosen. Whenever you feel like that, be warned. That is a lie from Satan. It would actually be pretty arrogant for us to think that the Son of God dying on a cross in our place is not enough to pay for our sins. That it's not enough to clean us from the uncleanness we feel. I'm telling you this morning, you can trust our good Heavenly Father. Okay, if God says it's enough, it's enough. You can stop doubting and believe Him. Trust your good, good Father, because the kingdom comes with unlimited grace, right? Only the unworthy get in. But there's another side of this truth, actually. The kingdom comes only with unlimited grace. You have to be unworthy. You can't get in any other way. You know, in 1924, one of the biggest social events of the whole year was the wedding of Cornelia Vanderbilt to British aristocrat John Cecil. Here's a picture of the wedding procession into the church. And I want you to notice in this picture the hundreds and hundreds of people standing outside the church. Now, Cornelia was the only child of George and Edith Vanderbilt. She inherited a large personal fortune and the massive Biltmore estate. It originally sat on 125,000 acres of land. Once you entered the property, it took you an hour by carriage ride to get to the house. It's still the largest private residence in the United States. Well, Cornelia grew up as an only child on the estate. And so there were no other children of her age and social rank for her to play with. So she ended up playing with a lot of the children of the staff and servants, and some of them became her really good friends. Well, a tour guide at the Biltmore related this story to my wife about how when Cornelia got married, many of the wealthy and famous guests arrived to the wedding only to find out there was no room for them in the church. They had to stand outside in the blazing sun during the ceremony because Cornelia had seated many of the estate workers' families and some of her childhood friends inside the church. The unworthy received places of honor while those more deserving were left outside. That is exactly how the kingdom of God works. Only the unworthy get in. This means if you feel like you're a pretty good person, if you feel like, boy, you try pretty hard, you're very sincere in trying to follow God, you try and keep His commandments, you do the right things, right? If you feel like unlimited grace, I mean, that's a great thing for those people who have really messed up, but that's not you. If you feel like that, you are outside the kingdom. You're not in. You're going to be left standing outside. Because receiving God's unlimited grace is the only way to enter the kingdom. Until you realize you are unworthy. Until you realize you don't deserve it. Until you realize you are not good enough. You can't enter the kingdom of heaven. Now, the kingdom comes with unlimited grace, and it comes only with unlimited grace. You have to understand how unworthy you are. But that's not all the kingdom of God comes with. This parable is about to take one shocking final twist as Jesus shows us this final group and the final essential truth. Take a look at verse 11. But when the king came in to see the guests, he noticed a man there who was not wearing wedding clothes. He asked, "How did you get in here without wedding clothes, friend?" The man was speechless. Then the king told his attendants, "Tie him hand and foot and throw him outside into the darkness where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth, for many are invited, but few are chosen." So after extending an open invitation to anyone to come to the feast, good or bad, the king comes in, he inspects the wedding guests, and this guy gets thrown out. Except he's not just thrown out of the wedding feast, he's thrown into what sounds a lot like hell, which kind of seems out of proportion to his mistake of not wearing the right clothes to the wedding, right? So what's going on here? Clearly, the man was invited to the wedding because it was open to anyone that they could find. And clearly, this guy accepted the invitation. He shows up to the wedding, unlike the enemies of God. So are you following where this is going? He accepted the free invitation to the king's banquet, but he still ends up in judgment. Evidently, there is a way for you to respond to God's invitation that still leads to destruction. If you weren't paying attention before, I hope you are now. Because Jesus is telling us some Christians will go to hell. What? How is that possible? Let me explain. Give me a second here. The key is this issue of the wedding clothes. Now, some people have suggested maybe the wedding clothes were provided by the king to all of the guests. There's just not great evidence for that in the first century. Others have suggested that the wedding clothes stand for the righteousness of Christ that must be applied to our accounts. That sounds really good. It's very biblical. But again, we have to be careful not to read details into this parable that just aren't there, because that's not clear. What is significant is when the king asks the man, "Why are you not wearing the wedding clothes?" The man has no response. He has no excuse, which tells us he knows what the expectation is, and he could have met it, but he chose not to. This man represents the third group of people, those who presume on God's grace. Although the invitation was free, this man presumed there were no obligations with it. He responds to God's invitation, but he pays no attention to God's requirements. But wait, maybe you're wondering, like, how can you presume on God's grace if it's unlimited grace? You see, unlimited grace means there is forgiveness available for anything we have done. But, and this is so important, we must receive God's grace on God's terms. Just because it's unlimited grace doesn't mean there aren't requirements that come with it. Okay, Jesus is emphasizing the interaction of divine grace and our human responsibility. And this is why there will be people who think they are Christians, who think they've received God's unlimited grace, but they won't be in heaven because they didn't really receive God's grace on God's terms. They aren't actually Christians at all. This is the third essential truth about the kingdom. The kingdom comes with unlimited grace, and third, the kingdom comes with unlimited demands. There's unlimited demands that come with the kingdom. God's grace is completely free, but that doesn't mean it doesn't come with obligations, right? You cannot just pray a prayer for salvation and then go about living your life your own way and think you're going to be in heaven one day. That's not how it works, right? Salvation is completely free, but there are requirements if you accept it. But if you go on living your old life, if you go on chasing your favorite sins, you show you never really got it. You show that you never really received that unlimited grace. You show you never really believed. Many people in the crowds that followed Jesus were part of this group. They presumed on God's grace. I mean, they loved the miracles. They loved the healings. They loved it when Jesus embarrassed the religious leaders. They loved the free food. They loved the feeling of being around Jesus' disciples and being a part of this group. But they weren't ready to accept following Jesus on Jesus' terms. They weren't ready to make him Lord over their lives. Is that you? You know, in the 1700s, George Whitefield was a famous evangelist. He traveled all throughout the American colonies, teaching and preaching the gospel. He would hold these large outdoor evangelistic events, and they were massive. They would draw thousands of people in the 1700s. And it was after one occasion where he had preached the gospel, and thousands had responded to the gospel message. Someone afterwards asked him, "George, this was amazing. How many people got converted today?" And he said, "We'll know in 5 years." Because Whitefield knew it takes time to see who has truly accepted God's unlimited grace with his unlimited demands and who is just presuming on God's grace. Accepting God's gracious offer of the kingdom means accepting God's unlimited demands. So if you want Jesus to be your Savior, you have to bow before him as your Lord. Now, we're not going to do that perfectly in this life. But if you don't find you have that desire to be submitted and surrendered to him, if you find that there's nothing in you that really wants to follow him and live the way Jesus calls us to live, if you aren't willing to accept his unlimited demands on your life, on your time, on your resources, on your relationships, then you should ask if you ever really received his unlimited grace in the first place. Now, one scholar concluded, we can expect millions of nominal Christians to be shocked to discover themselves excluded from God's kingdom on Judgment Day. How do you know if that's you? I mean, do you do things you know are wrong because you tell yourself, oh, God will forgive me? You know, do you disregard parts of the Bible because I think that couldn't possibly apply to us anymore? Do you feel like maybe you could do some religious things to kind of make up for your sin and God will overlook what you've done wrong? Do you think repentance means, hey, just tell God you're sorry and maybe whip up some guilty feelings in your heart and maybe kind of punish yourself a bit when you really have no intention of changing how you live? Or do you think God will accept you on your terms because, hey, he's a loving God, right? I mean, God wants our whole lives. He's worthy of everything. And when you truly love him, when you are so thankful for what he's done for you, boy, you want to live a life that's surrendered to him, that brings him honor and glory because of what he's done for you. Now, Jesus shows us these three groups and these three truths because he wants us to know where we stand with God. He does not want us to be surprised on Judgment Day. So how about you? Which of these three groups describes where you're at with God? The enemies of God? Those unworthy of God? Or those presuming on God's grace? Only one of those groups is going to be in the kingdom. Now, we're going to close our service today with some time to reflect on where we stand with God and reflect on what Jesus has done for us as we celebrate the Lord's Supper together. But if you realize that you've been an enemy of God, maybe you've been opposed to him, maybe you've just been indifferent to him, you can repent. You can admit that you've messed up. He is gracious and he is merciful. He'll forgive you. He'll change you if you turn to him and cry out to him. Maybe today you're feeling that burden on your heart. Maybe you realize you've been presuming on God's grace. You thought you could follow Jesus on your own terms and everything would still be good. Repent. Ask God to change you. Surrender to Him. Bow down to Him. Receive His gift of unlimited grace on His terms. Surrender it all to Him. Ask Him to help you. Now, in a minute, I'm going to give you the opportunity to respond to God from your heart. Maybe you're feeling Jesus' tug on your heart to surrender to Him and to be right with Him. I'm going to give you that chance in a minute. Because no matter what you've done, Jesus still loves you. He left His place in heaven to become one of us so that He could live a sinless, perfect life, healing people and teaching people and pointing the way to God, and then going to the cross on our behalf. See, God chose Him to be our substitute. He allowed Jesus to take our place because our sin, it deserves death. It deserves punishment and separation from God. And that's why Jesus died on the cross, to take your punishment for you so that God could forgive you and you could be reconciled to Him. 3 days later, after He died on the cross, He rose from the dead. He broke the power of sin and death over us. And now He's exalted to heaven, waiting for the day when He's going to come back in glory and power to rule this world and to heal this world. He's ready to be your Savior, but you've got to bow before Him as your Lord. You can do that today. He's merciful and He's gracious. And if you're feeling that tug in your heart, I want to encourage you to cry out to Him today. You can pray with me right now. It's not a magic prayer. It's not about these specific words. It's about your heart calling out to God in faith, believing that Jesus died for you, asking Him to save you and change you. So if that's your desire this morning, let's go to God right now. Let's bow our heads in prayer. And you can pray with me in your heart. Call out to God in your heart. Tell Him, Lord Jesus, I know I've sinned against You. I'm humbled that You would die for me. Today, I accept how much You love me. I believe You died for me. And I trust that Your death is the only thing that can take away my sins. God, I bow before You. I surrender my life to You, the risen King. I choose to follow You with my life. God, please forgive me and cleanse me and make me new. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, if you took that step today, we are really excited for you. Okay, that is the start of a personal relationship with God. Let us know that you took that step so we can celebrate with you and help you get growing with God. A couple of easy ways to do that. You can fill that out on your Connect card, mark that box that says, today I made Jesus the Savior of my life. You can turn it in the black boxes on the wall on your way out or at the connection desk in the hall. Or, as always, you can text Jesus to our number, 920-717-1715, and we'll reach out to you. We'd love to celebrate with you. Now, we're going to close our time today as we reflect on the cross by celebrating the Lord's Supper together, which means if you're part of the unworthy, okay, if you have chosen to follow God, to receive His gift of unlimited grace, and you're committed to following Jesus, I want to invite you right now to thank God again for what He's done for you. When we celebrate the Lord's Supper together, we're remembering Jesus' death for us. We're remembering how His body was broken for us. We're remembering how His blood was poured out because of our sins. We celebrate that we belong to Him by faith. And we remember that He's coming back again. And I want to invite you, If you've been a believer for maybe many, many years, or maybe today is the first day you've trusted Christ, I want to invite you to celebrate the Lord's Supper with us. Now, we're going to pass out the communion elements during this time of reflection, this song. But as this song plays, reflect on what Jesus has done for you. Reflect on how you've been reconciled to God if you chose to follow him by faith. Okay, but when you receive the elements, don't eat and drink yet. I'm going to come back after this reflection song and we'll eat and drink together. But this morning, if you've never taken the step to surrender your life to Jesus, that's okay. We're just excited that you're here with us today. But today would not be the day to participate in the Lord's Supper. Okay, this is for born-again believers in Jesus Christ. Or maybe you are a believer, but there's a sin issue in your life that you haven't been willing to deal with yet. Then today's not the day for you to participate either. The Bible warns us there can be serious consequences for participating in the Lord's Supper in an unworthy manner. Doing so, you can eat and drink judgment on yourself. But we're going to use this time to reflect, to seek God and remember what Jesus has done and celebrate that gift to us. So let's pray. Father God, Lord, we just thank you for this time. As we reflect on what you've done for us, Jesus, we invite you to meet us here in this moment. God, I pray if any of us are unsure where we stand, that you would make it so clear. Have we been living as your enemies? God, have we been presuming on your grace? Or God, are we just part of those unworthy that you've reached down and saved and forgiven? God, remind us again of your love and your sacrifice as we remember you. In Jesus' name, amen.